Now, to introduce our featured guest, Felicia Day. As Neil Patrick Harris says, everything Felicia creates seems to succeed. It's a great endorsement. Online entertainment pioneer, actress, and self-proclaimed queen of the geeks, Felicia Day has written a quirky, inspiring, funny New York Times bestselling, if I didn't mention that already, I just mentioned it again, memoir, You're Never Weird on the Internet, Almost. In the book and on stage tonight, Felicia will discuss her unusual upbringing, her rise to internet stardom, and how embracing her weirdness helped her find her place in the world. From Buffy to Supernatural, Eureka, Dr. Horrible's sing-along blog, The Guild, and more, Felicia has become one of the most influential creators in new media, and her book and story are proof that everyone should celebrate what makes them different and be brave enough to share it with the world, which is like such an amazing and important message. Felicia is joined in conversation tonight by world-renowned alternate reality game designer Jane McGonigal, author of the new book Super Better, a revolutionary approach to getting stronger, happier, and braver, powered by the science of games. So please join me to welcome Felicia and Jane.
Hello. Oh, duh. Hello. Hi, Jane. How are you?
Good. And hello. Am I Mike?
Uh-oh. Let me look inside you. Now talk.
Hello.
Yes. I just added sound design person to my resume.
Outstanding. Well, congratulations on writing this amazing book. And as soon as they invited me to do this with you, I said yes, because you are like a magnet for creative, interesting people. And so let us celebrate the fact that we're in a room full of, I think, very amazing, cool,
I think
creative people.
Everybody, I think we'd applaud ourselves for being amazing and
interesting. Thank you guys for coming out. We are going to talk about your amazing book and your amazing life, and we already have a stack of questions. So I'll ask a few to get started, and then we'll go right into what these people want to know. But let's start with the name of the book, which I think is one of the greatest memoir titles of all time. You're Never Weird on the Internet, Almost.
It took almost as long to come up with the title that it did to do a draft of the book.
Is that right?
Well, I came up with the idea for the title after I finished my draft, and then we were like, no, it's too long. So then I literally spent 3 months, and I have like doodles of terrible thing, like the aquarium of yourself, and like terrible, really bad, like, oh, I don't know who I am. I mean, just terrible, terrible titles. I should probably do a dramatic reading of all the bad things that I came up with.
Yes.
You know what, when I get back to my hotel room, I'll see if I have that notebook. It was, and I would literally just like, oh, I'm an awful person, geekarium, no. Geekette. Oh, bleh. So then after 3 months of that, we decided to go with the original idea, which was like, yay, kind of. Yes, so thank you for that compliment.
Yeah, that's great. So you're never weird, but you are weird. You admit it. The first chapter is titled Why I'm Weird.
Yeah.
And it's all about your homeschooled upbringing. So tell us a little bit about that, and do you feel like that really shaped your interests, how you learn, you know, in the career that you've built for yourself?
Yeah, I mean, I think especially writing a memoir is a good way to learn a lot about yourself you didn't know. So I would advise anybody, if you're kind of feeling like, I don't know what I'm doing right now in my life, just be like, I'm going to tell everyone the story of me. And you actually learn a lot about who you are and add up things in your life that bring you to now or wherever you are in life. And I think the most formative thing was my being homeschooled. I never went to school after the age of seven. And then I went to college when I was like 15, just turned 16. So like I had no formative years around other humans, which was interesting in that I know that I'm much more socially awkward and anxious, and I feel rejection a lot more because I wasn't rejected enough in my life. I guess that's something not to complain about, but But, you know, we were very unschooled. I did whatever I want. If you read in the book, like, my mom would just sleep in, and I would bring her breakfast, and we'd kind of go out to lunch, and then we'd go to lessons. And that was literally no tests, no homework, just lessons, and lost in space at 10 a.m. I was always good about that appointment. That robot. That he was such a creepy guy. What was his name? Yes. Come on. What? Anyway, let's move on. So anyway, I kind of grew up loving the things I love without anyone saying, you shouldn't love that. And I do think that being able to be as weird as I want to be, which I didn't consider weird, I just thought it was me, allowed me to grow up in a bubble that led to, I don't know, here, being weird on a stage.
Okay, let's get weirder. So you went to college, as you said, at 15, just turned 16, on a violin scholarship and with a math major. Which is a little bit different from what you're doing today.
So no, connect
the dots.
Yeah. there are no dots to connect, Jane. I mean, I got a math degree because I happen to be really good at it. Because as I say in my book, my mother told me that once you start your period, you can't learn math as a girl. Which isn't true, guys.
That's not true.
Gonna dispel that
rumor. Do a public service announcement.
I mean, public service announcement that
you
does
can
not.
Do math
you can do
on
math
your period.
On your
okay.
period.
All right.
Sorry about talking about periods, men. But then I was like really anxious because my grandpa was a physicist, and whenever I tell him like, "Hey, grandpa, I learned the Pythagorean theorem," he'd be like, "Great, here's a candy." So I was like, "This is awesome. I get candy when I do math." And other praise. And I was like, I really like doing math and I like being good at math and I enjoy numbers floating in my head and letters and shapes. So I learned it. And even after I did that world event of my adulthood, the period, I did learn math. I was able to retain it in my brain. So when I went to college, I got a full scholarship for violin, but I was like, I don't know if I want to be a violinist for the rest of my life, because playing Handel's Messiah every single Easter for the rest of my life is not appealing. I mean, it's a beautiful piece, but it's not it's the same piece over and over. We've been playing it for hundreds of years. We probably should get some new tunes. So I started taking a bunch of math classes, and then because I was like, I should think about a backup plan here, which my real plan was acting. You're looking at me like I'm wandering, which I am.
No,
but
no,
it's true. So anyway, I ended up getting the math degree and studying music the whole time, and then kind of taking other courses that I thought were interesting until the time where I got on a bus and went to Hollywood. So that's not a good plan either, guys.
Well, you have this amazing story in the chapter about the violin, like the performance you have to do. It's like a recital. And I feel like you approached it, that was like an early inclination of what you would go on to do with, like, for example, the Guild. So can you tell them about this, like, the poster?
Oh, yeah, the poster. And this is funny because somebody tweeted me that a friend of his had this poster I made up on their cubicle wall for years. Like, not knowing, I mean, I was not, like, Felicia, it was not even on the internet, but somebody loved this poster. So when you're a music major, you have to do two recitals, and you have to get people in the room, and it is hard to assemble a lot of people to watch a classical music concert. You blackmail a lot of people, you're like, hey, friends, I'm showing up to yours, aka show up to mine. And so I was determined to fill the room because it takes 10 hours a day practicing these pieces. I'm not gonna play to an empty room. I was gonna give away donuts, but I needed a new plan. So I actually made up, and this was, you know, just when I found the internet as it was, because of the computer lab. I would go up there and I found this thing called a browser, and the internet was amazing. This thing called the internet with this browser Usenet thing. I could talk about Wheel of Time to people, you know. I loved it. So I decided to make my own poster, and instead of just me, you know, with a picture of myself, I was like, I should put my head on Xena, Princess Warrior.
As you do.
So in the book, you'll see it. It's me on, you know, Lucy Lawless's body. And instead of a sword, it's a flaming violin.
So cool.
And it looks pretty great. I actually had three versions of it, but I only put one in the book. So maybe I should share the other one. And another one has my pianist on Gabrielle's body. And her head's like this. You know, it wasn't good Photoshop, but I was so proud of myself. And this was before memes and stuff, guys. So I put them everywhere in the music building and I was like, checkmate. But the dean took them down because it was a taste level thing. And then everyone stole them anyway, so...
And now they're like collector's items.
They were collector's items. They were collector's items in the music building.
They would be worth a lot today. We should tweet and find out.
We should see if anybody has the original one. No, somebody did say, hey, my friend in the cubicle had one of those for
years. I feel
like
we could auction that for charity. That would be, write it down. We're going to do that.
Yeah.
I love that. Okay, so this was clearly, you were thinking really creatively about promotion and doing weird things. So
promotion plus weird things equals my career. I guess that's it.
Exactly. So here you're on your way to Hollywood, and then along the way you decide to kind of opt out of the studio system and make your own art. So tell us a little bit about
that. Well, that was like a 6-year journey of being like, hey, I love Fritos kind of career. I mean, I moved to LA, I didn't know anything, and I've actually now added it up. It's because I did so much theater all my life. As a kid, I would move around because my dad was in the military, so I would do like 6 Can-Can Girl from the Left over and over, because I was never, you know, the star, but I was like, small plays, you know, like the Oliver orphan, number 15 in the back, like, herpeter, and... I loved it. I loved the theater. I loved showing up to rehearsal and making a show with people. And I felt like belonged. And I interacted with people of all ages. But everybody was brought together for this one thing they loved, which was theater. And I was like, well, Hollywood's just like that. Let's get on a bus. Which didn't turn out to be the same. It's really weird. It's not that way.
Not the same.
And just standing on a corner being semi-pretty doesn't work either. So that didn't work for me. And... then I just started doing whatever I could to, you know, to win Hollywood, which is not a winnable equation because it's all about luck, connections, and your outer appearance. And my outer appearance didn't fit what people saw inside of me, which eventually got really frustrating after I was, you know, hey, could I have a coffee and a Dunkin' Donut? Because they're amazing. You know, I did so many commercials, you guys. I would go 5-6 times a day and I would audition for commercials, and it's a great career because you do one commercial and you can make like $30,000. I mean, you work one day, but it's the most boring, terrible, you know, sort of cattle call thing where you're just, hey, it's a line of redheads, pick one. So I was unhappy, and that's why I became addicted to World of Warcraft, which was a great thing.
I know. You are not alone in this room on that, I'm sure.
I think there are a lot of wow people. Are there a lot of wow people here? Oh, we brought the lights up and everything. There's a lot of warlocks in the house. For the horde, be quiet.
Now you're starting trouble.
Fight, 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 fight. No, I'm just kidding. I love World of Warcraft. I started playing that because of my brother, but
thank you.
What's going on?
We got some backup. By the way, is there actually a clock on stage or not?
A what?
Oh, there's a clock. There's no actual clock, I don't think. So you'll just have to wave at us. Okay.
Or just sneak up behind me and scare me again. That was good. I almost punched her.
Nice reflexes.
But you also
had this kind of like existential moment that you write about in the book, sort of waking up in terror at 3:45 in the morning. That seemed to be in addition to not enjoying the commercial life. So tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so my brother invited me to WoW, and I love WoW, and I will always love WoW, and I would never say that video games they were not a bad influence in my life until I let them be, as well as I felt like a sense of belonging and a family with my guild and my guildies that was never to be surpassed. So, I mean, my story is not one like games are terrible or games are addictive, because
then
we
really would get into a fight.
We would.
Yeah.
You have a good right punch, I can tell. I won't, let's not go there. I love games, and games are like literally the joy in my life and the thread that I know connects me with other people in a positive way. But I was very unhappy being an actor, and I wasn't succeeding where I thought I was doing everything I could, and it just wasn't an academic world. It isn't an academic world where the harder you work, the further you get ahead. And that was my life up until then. Like, the harder you do math, the better you are. The harder you do music, the better you are. All of those things were equations, and that's not what Hollywood is. So I was unhappy, and instead of just playing 3 or 4 hours a day, which is fine, because I do that quite frankly. I mean, how do you get stuff done in less than 3 hours, right? You can't. I mean, commuting is half the day, right? God, unless you're a mage. Whatever. So I just kind of just, because I was unhappy, I would just fill the rest of my time with World of Warcraft because it made me happy in a temporary way. But it was really just a Band-Aid on the fact that I just was kind of unhappy, and rather than deal with what was underneath, because I really wasn't that mature enough to identify there's something going on here that is causing you to, you know, raid 8, 9, 10 times a week. I decided to just play and play and play. And at a certain point, a lot of people were like, hey, this doesn't seem positive because you aren't doing anything else with your life. So I had to quit because you're right. I had this existential crisis where I would literally wake up in the morning. I would go to bed thinking, what do I have to do in the morning to do like dailies and make potions? And then I'd have a checklist, and it got very sophisticated where I'd have like an organizational document where I would have my to-do list, kind of like, you know, entrepreneurs have, except for WoW. So I decided I had to quit cold turkey because I'm not a moderate person. I'm either 0 or 100.
And why writing?
So it was a thing that other people had said, hey, you should get into sketch writing. And I did a lot of improv comedy, and a lot of improv artists will take their improvs and turn them into sketches or get into sketch from there because, you know, you could do shows and things. And I thought, hey, that looks like a good community. And I took a sketch writing class, and I got into a support group. Guys, I know it sounds really dorky, but it was an amazing support group of like 5 other women who we got together every week and were like, hey, I, you know, did 10 pages on my screenplay. I went on, you know, 10 auditions. I worked on my family. I did Zul Gurub 10 times and I got all the, you know, so I would go to that meeting and I would not really have anything to say except for gaming. And they didn't even know gaming. They were like, uh-huh. So at a certain point, I was shamed into writing, essentially. I really felt like I needed to step up my game, and by the end of the year, that year was 2006, I needed to write a script. And because I loved gaming, and I love gamers, and I never saw people portray gamers the way I saw gamers, which was not just a surly teen in a basement, which, no insult, surly teens. But that's not all-encompassing about what gaming is to me. And I wrote about these, you know, I wrote about characters that I loved, and it turned into The Guild. So that's it.
Yay! All right, I have lots of questions about your experience with The Guild, but I also have like 5 million questions from the audience. So why don't we take a break for my questions?
We're going to go to your audience questions?
Yeah, let's
go to
the audience questions. Okay, because I kind of really like these questions. Now, some of you didn't write your name on the card. If you would like to like holler and wave at Felicia when I read your question, you should do that, you know, so you can wave at whoever. Okay, so this person wrote 9 questions, so you know who you are already, probably.
Okay, now come on.
And I like this first question. What makes you the happiest these days?
That's a really good question. I bet this person is the kind that stands there at the ice cream shop and samples everything.
Ah. Who is this person? There you are.
Hey, there you are.
Awesome.
Hi, you're lovely. I didn't mean to insult you. I'm always jealous of you, but I don't have the balls to actually do that. I'm always like, damn it, I wanted the sorbet too. Okay, what makes me happiest?
Yeah, like these days.
I mean, the things that make me happiest are like spending time with people I appreciate. And I guess that's a small, broad, that is broadly encompassing in releasing a new piece of content and seeing how the community reacts. That's like joyous to me. Having a board game night and introducing somebody to a new game is joyous to me.
Introduce us to a new game. What are you playing these days that you're excited about?
Well, I'm playing Kingdom Rush Redux, which if you guys haven't played Kingdom Rush, right here, tower defense in the house. I've been playing that obsessively, not in a bad way, in a good way. An airport waiting room gateway. And tower defense to me is the one thing I subscribe to people who want to get organized. Because it's a game where you have to plan a path and you have to do towers. A few of you are nodding. And you have to kill a bunch of bad guys before they get to the end of the path, essentially. So it's all about like planning ahead the steps of how you're going to approach the oncoming onslaught of disaster, which is basically life.
True.
So
true.
Whenever I get stuck on a script or anything, I play tower defense, and I feel like it organizes my brain in a really healthy way.
It totally does.
You would know
by the
this.
Way. Yes. No. Neuroscientifically, it totally works. So we will.
Your book is amazing.
This.
Her book is amazing about gaming and neuroscience. So when it comes out, you guys should check it out.
We will talk about that again.
Okay.
All right. So many cute questions on this card. This is one that I've heard a lot of people ask when they see your book, so I'm going to go right to that one. This one says, hi, Felicia, and you also asked about, oh, it's Caitlin. Is Caitlin?
Caitlin.
There's Caitlin.
Wow, awesome. They're right next to each other.
Okay. So good job, you guys. Like, you killed it on the questions. Where did you get that dress on the cover? Is it real? How did you choose it?
Okay, this dress, by the way, it's pretty badass. I'm sorry.
And this is not just like, this is a
real print.
Simulation.
There's a place, and I can't remember the name of it. I wish I could give a shout out, but there's a place where you could literally design fabric, and then they'll make a dress out of it. It's like so badass. Huh. So if I'll tweet it out later for everybody to see, but I have like three dresses they printed up for the cover, and it was too big for me. I guarantee, okay, here's a secret, a Hollywood secret you guys probably don't know, is that every single actress in pretty much every show will have those clothespins in the back to make your waist look better. So that was this, because it came a little bit too big, and so it's all pinned up in the back. But the front, it looks very good.
We
so.
Could like make that a thing, just wearing clothespins on your back.
They had that in the 80s. Oh, don't you remember that?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Guys,
safety
it was like
pins,
two little clips.
Clothespins.
It was like a, were they called? They're like called back scrunchies, or lower lumbar scrunchies?
Back scrunchies? No.
I bet they have them at Urban Outfitters. It's a what?
Fashion clip.
Fashion clip.
All right, they're coming back.
Meaning the least fashionable thing you can wear.
We'll be bringing them back. Okay, I like this one. This is very practical.
Okay.
This is Stephanie. Where's Stephanie? All right.
Steph.
Hi, Stephanie. My friends and I started a YouTube channel about nerdy, geeky things. What advice would you give to new YouTubers? By the way, say the name of your channel so you can get a bunch of new subscribers.
Ace of Geeks.
Ace of Geeks.
Ace of
awesome.
Geeks.
All right. So, yeah, what advice do you have to other geeky new YouTubers?
It's really, I mean, it's hard but good in a way because it's a very saturated world right now. There's a lot of entertainment and there's a lot of things just pulling at all of our attention. So I would say be patient and make sure you're talking about something that you love and consume a lot of other people's content. To see what, not to be like, hey, I'm gonna best that person, but like be inspired by what they do in a good or a bad way. There's nothing better than seeing a horrible movie and being like, what the hell was that? I could do that better. And that's a good motivator. Or you could see something that really inspires you, like, I wanna be like that person. So there's a couple of kinds of inspiration that you can have, not in a negative way, but just in a like, hey, I see a way to do that differently that I would do. So I would say do your research, love what you're talking about, and value your fans because trying to cast your net too wide and grow too fast will make your fans feel unappreciated. And actually, if you have a smaller fan base, you could spend more time and it'll be a sticky situation. They'll be more of a sticky relationship where they feel like they're hanging out with you. And honestly, in the times in my career where I've gotten kind of blown up and much bigger and people don't know who I am but comment on my hair in a way that they don't know me, and that those are the most unsatisfying things that I've encountered. Like, it's really when I've gone back and like, let's create a real community. Like, Team Human, is there Team Humans in the house? Yeah. People who are in my Twitch channel, like, we have an amazing Twitch presence, and like that community makes me feel like I'm coming home to friends when I am there, whenever I can be there, and the fact that they're friends together. So you want to create like an architecture for people to connect with you and your content and with each other. So I would just that's all that.
All right. Good advice for Ace of Geeks. I love it. Well, so speaking of blowing up your community, this is a good question from Josh. Josh, you want to wave hi?
Josh,
there you are.
Like your hat.
As you started seeing more success in your career and efforts, how did you handle things when it hit the occasional plateau?
That's a good question. I do talk about in my book, I have a chapter on depression and anxiety, and I think the culmination of that chapter is really about too much pressure, overwork, and not knowing where to go from where I was. I mean, I think outwardly, especially when I first started my company, Geek & Sundry, everybody thought, hey, thank you, Geek & Sundry. Thank you, guys. So I started this company not knowing what I was doing. I was just like, hey, here's some shows I really want to make. But, you know, I didn't realize that when you make that things at that scale, and you don't have the resources to hire the dozens of people you need, you only have half a dozen, that it's a huge burden. I mean, it's a huge workload. And, you know, we were kind of like, I appreciate the opportunity to start a company, but I didn't know how to start a company. So it was a big learning curve, and I felt like my reputation was on the line, and I felt like, you know, I couldn't let it fail, so I had to, I would heavy lift anything that I could do. And my friends were on the channel, so I felt double loyalty to try to make everything as instantly popular as possible. Mm-hmm. And that wasn't realistic. And I ended the guild that year, and that put me into huge depression. I talk very frankly about, like, just, you know, being disassociating with myself, having imposter syndrome. And I think, you know, I don't want to be cavalier about, you know, it, but success can bring a lot more pressure and depression and negative things as you think that failure brings you. So I've always kind of operated up until then about, like, if I only got there, I'd be happy. Or if I only succeeded here, I would be fulfilled. And there isn't an equation where something in the distance is going to make you happy. You have to be happy in the moment, and you have to carry that along with you on the bumpy path to wherever it is you think you want to go. So I guess that would be the lesson that I learned from that. And it was really hard to go through. And it made me appreciate the smaller things more than trying to aim for the stars for some arbitrary reason that might make me happy, but it ultimately wouldn't.
Well, I think a lot of people, readers like myself, will really appreciate how honest and bravely you talk about depression and anxiety, even in the middle of success, because it does seem, you know, unlikely. You think everything will be wine and roses. And
no,
I mean, you do a great job of vulnerable and brave to talk about that.
Well, I think that more people should talk about it. And I didn't have somebody to look to when I was going through all that, except for some Sundance movies. You know, like, oh, it's a woman having a breakdown, you know. But people deal with that every day, and you know, realizing, I think once you to know is to own something. And I was operating for many years with not knowing how much anxiety was literally ruling every second of my life, and how much my mood would go up and down, and I would let it go up and down, not realizing that, hey, maybe this isn't actually what's happening, what I'm feeling. And being able to be like, hey, you're having a panic attack. Hey, panic attack, stop it. I mean, or at least kind of calm down, because you don't need to be having a panic attack right now. I mean, I have it still, but at least knowing that I'm going through something, I'm able to, like, parent myself through it and handle it a little bit better. And if somebody had told me that years before, I think life would have been a lot not easy. It would be a little easier. It would be.
Nice. Well, you're about to make someone very happy. This is a request from Jen. Hi, Felicia. It's my best friend's birthday. Can you say happy birthday, Nikki?
Happy birthday, Nikki. Are you
Yay!
Here? Hi, Nikki.
Yay!
There are a couple other birthday people in the house, actually. I met one or two other. Who else's birthday? Right here. Right here. Two birthday people.
Woo!
Your parents had sex during Christmas, right?
Is that how it works?
Or Thanksgiving? I don't know. Let's all figure it out later. On Valentine's Day. Oh, yours? Yeah.
Romantic.
That's a common one, too.
That's good. All right. I love this question.
Okay.
This is one of my favorite questions I've ever seen at any of these events. All right. The zombie apocalypse has struck. Form your ideal team out of three characters from projects you've been in.
Wow.
Could be your characters you played or other characters. Who wrote this awesome question? Way
really
in the back.
Question.
Good job. Good job. Very good question.
That is a really good question.
I know.
Three characters plus me. All right. Huh? Oh, what was that?
The Winchester for you.
I mean, the Winchesters would be really handy. Like, they're really good at all firearms and twirling knives and tallness. So I guess I Buffy would be pretty great too. I was on House one episode.
House and Buffy. Okay.
First of all, doctor. Second of all, hottie.
Okay, so Buffy House, are you going to go with?
Buffy House, can I have the Winchesters as one unit?
Yes. All right.
There we go.
Super team. I would like to challenge the audience. I'd like to see some fan fiction out of that, please. Not, doesn't have to be slash fiction. I'm saying fan fiction. Okay.
Should be slash fiction.
It could be
slash.
It could be. Yeah. Okay. I like it.
You say that and yet you're flipping through them.
I'm paying my respects.
Okay. You're getting your attention, you're not getting your question. I'm sorry. She's a very discriminating person. With excellent shoes.
Good. I want to ask you one of my questions now.
Okay. Oh, wow. Is so wrong.
That was mean, wasn't it? I have, you guys, I'm a geek too. I made like all, I printed things out.
Wait,
and
you
taped
printed them and then you taped
notebook.
Them?
Yes. Yes. Because I, like you, am kind of weird.
I
and,
love you.
And a little bit of a geek.
You know, whenever you're on TV or movies and people are reading books or like paperwork, especially, the prop people have to make that. Oh. It all has to be original. And often you'll be like, they'll be like, especially if there's a case file, even on like Supernatural or something like that, or other movies I've been on, there'll be like some official things like the perpetrator was a 24-year-old white man, and it goes like poop, 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 anus. And eventually it'll just get crazy sauce. And it's so funny that you're reading and you're trying to keep it straight. You're like, I'm on camera and I cannot laugh, but I just saw the word dick.
Now I feel bad. I don't want to ask my own questions.
No, so ask your questions.
Okay.
Ask your questions.
No, okay.
Okay.
So,
I mean,
do you plan on making any more music videos?
Oh, that's a good question. Yes, I want to. I did a book song tour. Did anybody see my book tour song? No. Not enough of you. I posted a lot, and it, to the point where one guy was like, stop posting this. But you know what? Clearly I needed to post it more. He was paying attention too much.
Hey.
Ask one of your questions, because
they're beautifully done. Well, actually, so I asked Twitter for some questions.
Oh, good.
So I really like one of these. This is from Christian Wilson on Twitter, who's, I assuming, not here, but I will tweet at her later and tell you, because this is a number question, number breakdown. In your opinion, what is the percentage breakdown of your success? Hard work, luck, and skill?
Oh, that's a really good question. I'm glad she's not here. She would intimidate me. Hard work, luck, and skill. I mean, I definitely think hard work is like 80%. I do think that, you know, especially when you're swimming against the tide and convincing somebody that an idea that has not been done before is viable, especially in Hollywood, it's like ridiculous, guys, because that's a business of basically repeating success. And it's amazing that anything breaks out and is different. So I think that, and since I wasn't in kind of the Hollywood world, I was working in the digital tech world, I found that the openness to innovation is much heavier there.
Yeah.
Because innovation is rewarded in tech. That is where you get your billion-dollar companies or your brand new platform. So it was always more fun to go and pitch an idea to a tech person than Hollywood. It's a blank slate unless you're like, it's a procedural and she has family problems. I mean, but, you know, unless it's that, they don't want to touch it because their job is on the line. If it fails, then it's easier just to repeat what somebody else did and just do a twist. So I guess hard work would be 70% and skill would be 20 and luck would be 10%. Maybe give me more skill.
Oh yeah. Okay.
I mean, I'm not unskillful. I'm just saying that skill is great. I know so many actors who are so amazing that I've taken class with who never work. And a lot of it is, there is a factor of luck. But there is hard work. You have to pound the pavement. You have to be persistent. You have to have a vision. And you have to love it so much that even if you don't get that success ring, the doing of it is the reward. And I think that's kind of a key point that I've learned along the way, that even if the gold had never blown up and I still was doing, hey, I love Cheetos, you know, those commercials, I would still be making videos.
They're getting some good plugs from you still. I mean,
I know. Screw
they
that.
Got their money's worth.
They did. It was a good commercial. They made me look pretty. Anyway, rather than other ones that have made me look like somebody you wouldn't want to hang out with. Like a cat-owning spinster. I don't know. No insult to spinsters. Yeah, spinsterhood. Is that aware?
Like 70, we'll go with 70, 20,
I will go 10. Like 60, 30, 10.
60, 30, 10. Okay. Now, you're a gamer. I'm a gamer. Of course, I wanted to play a little game with you today.
Oh,
and this
okay.
game has a little story behind it.
Okay.
So I wanted to look for a really amazing quotation to kind of sum up how I felt about your book and how I think all of these amazing people will feel about your book. So I found this great quotation that I would like to share with you.
I'm going to lift this really heavy pitcher.
Yes, please. Okay, so...
It's really heavy. I'm not kidding. No, I'm going to... I don't want to touch it. It looks greasy. I don't know. Okay, just keep going.
Okay. All right, so this is a Dr. Seuss quotation.
Okay.
You did.
Thank you.
Guns. Okay, so Dr. Seuss once wrote famously, "We are all a little weird, and life's a little weird, and when we find someone whose weirdness is compatible with ours, we join up with them and fall in mutual weirdness and call it love." Isn't that great? That's so Felicia, right? That's like, yes,
yay,
right?
Dr. Seuss.
I love that. So yay, Dr. Seuss, but then because I'm like a kind of geeky science person, I wanted to make sure Dr. Seuss actually said that, so I looked it up, and there's like this whole great internet page about quotes that were never said by the famous people supposed to say them, and the
there's a page about internet people correcting people?
Oh. Yes, I know. Shocking.
Shocking.
Shocking. But apparently the person who said that is the guy who wrote Everything I Needed to Know I Learned in Kindergarten and not Dr. Seuss. So then I was like, that's not as exciting and
enchanting. What is that book about? Really?
Yeah, it's like life lessons from kindergarten. Not as exciting.
Anybody read that book?
Yes.
Oh, is it good? Great.
All right, put it on your Goodreads list.
I'm going to read it now.
Okay. But so then I thought, wow, this is like really crazy. People are quoted famously for not saying things. And then I found out, do you know that on the internet sites that collect famous quotes from famous people, you have many pages of famous quotes. So
me?
I thought I would read you some of the things you supposedly said, and we can find out if you actually said them and if you remember what they meant.
Okay.
Okay?
I like it.
Okay. So.
Okay.
So we want to know, did you say it? And then tell us in a line or two what you meant.
Okay.
Nobody sets out to break new ground. I think change comes when people have no other choice. A famous quote.
This is what I'm going to say. I'm really good at t-shirt quotes. I say this in the book. I'm like, I should have a cup and t-shirt company because I'm really good at phrases. So I could have been bullshitting something and that came out in a clever way. I will not discount. Sorry if they're children. Sorry. I think that I probably said something to that effect. It doesn't sound like the way I would say something.
Oh, interesting. Okay, so report, flag that one on the site.
But I remember saying something about the fact that no one will change unless they're forced to. We're never gonna really create global warming until it really gets crappy for us, right? Mm-hmm. We never, every revolution is kind of, if you look, because I love revolutions, the basis of it are people being thrown out on the street and not being able to eat, and they're at their last wit's end. So people will do what they need to do only when they're forced to do it, and that was really profound. So I'm gonna say yes, I said that.
All right. Okay. This is an acting quote. I think every role is always exciting and intimidating. I've never had a role where I wasn't intimidated by it.
That's true, because I'm always intimidated. I mean, I don't remember saying that, but I'm always intimidated, slightly anxious, and I believe that I messed a conversation up after I leave it.
Aw. Wait, no. Say more about that.
What? Every time I go to a social situation, like especially a party where I'm with you know, people who are fancy, like actors, and I'll go up and I'll be like, I'll have a conversation, I'll leave, and I'm like, they hate me. And then I'll wanna apologize to them in an email, and I won't, but then I won't be able to sleep because of it. So sometimes I get up and draft the email, and I don't send it, just to have apologized to someone for something. True story.
True story. Okay, now this quote, I was like, I have to ask you, because what is the context for this?
Okay.
My favorite Mr. Rogers episodes were always the ones where Mr. Rogers would go into the community. Famous Felicia Day quote.
Okay. No. I never said that. Mr. Rogers was one of my favorite things as a kid, but I like the creepy puppets the best.
Oh. Totally misquoted. Totally misquoted.
You know the ones that has face like a knuckle? They were so unattractive. Those puppets were scary as hell. And yet I was always like, get in there. Get in that world.
Okay, we'll do one more.
I also have a thing for men in cardigans. Sorry.
Okay, this one I think very intriguing possibilities here. I could go off into the wilderness and write fantasy novels and write fantasy novels for the rest of my life and probably be happy. Said it or didn't say it.
I don't think I'd go in the wilderness. That sounds uncomfortable.
You better check out this page, Felicia. They've got three, like, there's like three screens worth of things you've said.
I don't think I would have said I was gone in the wilderness.
Okay.
Because, I mean, I would have gone to a spa. I know that in interviews I have said that I could go and become a barista and be happy, some random place. Because sometimes the pressure is just a lot, and I'm like, it would just be fine. And I enjoy coffee, so I could have coffee every day for free at my own place, and I'd be like, make that coffee better to somebody.
Be that somebody.
I would be that. That somebody. And I could write. I would like to write a fantasy novel. I could, but I don't know. I don't remember saying that. I will say that.
Okay.
And it doesn't sound that profound, so it's fine if I unown it.
Brainyquotes.com, if you would like to see three pages of things Felicia may or may not have said. Speaking of writing fantasy novels, I mean, so you're a best-selling author. I think there may be more books in your future. And you have your amazing Goodreads book club.
I have a few. Oh, Veronica and Bonnie are here. Veronica and Bonnie, right here. My fellow co-host. Yes, we have a book club called Vaginal Fantasy. Woo! It's a romance genre book club. So we read things where girls kick an alien in the face and then make out with them.
A surprising number of those books.
It's a very deep genre. Deep genre. Yeah, it's really fun. And what was your point?
Do you think you'll write fiction? I would novels, love to write fantasy.
Yes, thing? I would love to write one. I don't know if it would be a young adult novel or one of those with the sexy times. I don't know if I could do it. I don't know. I could literally talk about all my childhood dysfunction and be like, well, it's fine. But I don't know if I could write a sex scene and be like, see, someone's reading it. I don't know if I could do it. I don't know.
I think I encourage you.
Okay. The sexy one or the young adult one?
Yes. Sexy time. But yeah, you're genre breaking. I mean, you know.
All right.
You could do it. Okay. Let's go back to awesome people asking awesome questions. There's no name on this, so wave at Felicia if this is you. Okay. How do you choose which projects or ventures to pursue?
Who's that person?
Right down here.
It's a good question. I am very, very busy and I take on too much and then I don't devote enough time to a lot of things. So I've been trying to like winnow down and, you know, this book was a really good lesson in putting the brakes on and just concentrating on the things that I really are getting fulfillment out of, which is creating something. And the great thing is that Geek & Sundry, my company now, is owned by Legendary and there's a lot of infrastructure to help all the things that I wasn't good at, to be honest with you, all those kind of business things. So now it's freeing me up. I mean, as a producer or a creator, like I'm drawn to are things that haven't been done before in a way that people haven't done it. So I'm like that person who's like first on a video, you know, that's just me. I'm that dick. Sorry. There's a 10-year-old here. I'm sorry, child. young lady. So those are the requirements. I'm not really interested in repeating things what other people do. And I like things that are delightful. I like things that make people feel joy and want to share them and just love them and create a community around them. So I guess those are the three things. Like first, what would I say?
New. You want to be first to do it.
First and delight and community. Awesome. Those are the three things, I guess. Awesome. Yeah.
I hope you have a really good answer to this question. This is from Sam13.
Sam13. You're the 13th Sam.
What is the weirdest thing you've ever done?
I mean, that's my life, guy. I mean, I will go to a city and immediately go to the torture museum or like the... I mean, come on. You would go. It's actually really good. It's in Vienna. It just has the Iron Maidens. Like, it's a real one. You see them in Diablo all the time. What's wrong with seeing them in person? Sorry. I will pick, like, the weirdest... Like, I had Filipino food for the first time today because I'm just like... It was good. Hollow. That was good. I have to say, I was very pleased. I love new experiences. And when I travel, I always go to the weirdest, oddest places. And like a weird wax museum or a puppet, you know, show or really odd food I really like to consume. And, you know, weird history. So I guess that's my whole life.
So you're always weird.
I'm always not weird, but just off. I like to surprise myself. I just... When someone, I'm the ultimate hipster. If someone's like, yeah, I went there, I'm like, I'm deliberately not going there. Thank you. God, I'm a douchebag. No. Sorry.
For your next memoir and a title.
Yes. I'm a douchebag.
I'm a douchebag. Memoir 2. Okay, I have to read this. It's intriguing. I don't know if you can answer this question publicly. You may need to give a special signal of some kind.
Okay, Jared and Jensen smell like oak and spices.
Oh, there it is.
Sandalwood.
Okay. This is from Mike. From a fellow redhead, I missed the last meeting. Where did Lord Tudyk say to deposit the non-ginger souls we collect? Maybe you can give a nod, a wink. All right.
Someone didn't read the bylaws.
Okay. Moving on. Thank you, Mike. This is a good, I like this one, talking about your legacy a little bit.
Okay.
What do you most want to be remembered for? Is it something you've already created, something in production, maybe something in the future?
I mean, I'd like it to be in the future because that means I won't be irrelevant after this point. So.
Good plan.
That would be nice. I would like to be known as somebody who inspired some people to embrace who they are a little bit more. Mm-hmm. I mean, ultimately, creating is not about you or the person creating. Us. I. Me. It's not about the person creating. It's about creating and giving it to other people and having it affect them in a way. And I think whether it's to make them laugh or make them to try something new or make them care about a subject they didn't care about, like you're showing them your worldview and that's shifting their worldview a little bit. And that requires openness on everyone's part. But when that happens, it's amazing because then we all affect each other. And I guess, you know, in writing this book, the reason why I did it was because my story has resonated with people and caused people to create web series or take, you know, Zumba class at night or just connect with someone they met. I mean, a couple people from our forum are getting married. And that, it's really cool. Someone here said that they met somebody and I caused intercourse with people, you know? It's really sweet. Last night, I enabled somebody to propose and it was pretty great. So I don't know. I think that I would love to, in saying something that hopefully reaches more people than even know who I am, that they try something different, they love themselves more, and they are brave to be able to connect with other people around that thing they love. Because no one should ever feel ashamed of who they are or what they love. And that's really the worst thing in this life, especially when we're growing up and we get bullied. You know, conformity is a kind of bullying, I think. Mm.
That is a famous Felicia Day quote.
Put that
on the board.
Put that on Brady Crow.
Put that on the board.
Put
conformity is a kind of bullying.
That is a Felicia Day quote. Put that instead of that Mr. Rogers quote.
I will suggest that. I will suggest that. Okay, so what would your superhero outfit look like?
Okay.
By the way, who is that? There's no name on the card. Who asked that awesome question?
Okay, no cape. Who the hell needs a cape? I just heard like an indrawn breath like I was a heathen. I just don't think it's a practical situation. I mean, even if I'm flying, why do you need that? It's showy. It's braggy and impractical. It's like having long hair when you're doing jujitsu. Like, it's just waiting there to sabotage you, okay? My opinion. Although they look cool. I love orange, so I would definitely be orange and iridescent. Because this effect right here on this book, this shiny thing, and plus, you know, it's a little 80s. I don't care. I would look like a little 80s. So it would be orange and maybe like some kind of like, I mean, I like this dress, so I'm kind of into these colors, right? Yeah. So it'd be this dress, but in a unitard, and I'd have really, I'd have muscles everywhere.
Keep pouring the water.
I don't think I'd have cleavage. I think I'd have a crew neck, just to be conservative. Not that there's anything wrong with it. I don't have much, so.
Okay. I've seen a lot of questions here about essential advice for geek girls. Here's a question. My daughter is 3. What advice would you give her in regard to how she should grow up? That's from Eric, by the way.
Eric
right there.
Hi.
What's your advice for young girls today?
That's pretty cool. I've met a lot of young girls, a lot, especially around Supernatural, which is a show that has a really young fan base. And it's very inspiring to me. And it makes me wish I was their age because I had no friends that age. And when I see them in a pack, I'm like, oh. That's cute. So I love it, and I feel like it's a very vulnerable time. And as a girl and a woman, and you can chime in, your point of view is very valid in these areas. I think you're told as a girl that the win conditions for girldom are being liked and being pretty. Mm-hmm. And those win conditions are things that you kind of abandon other things because you want to win. You want to be popular. You want to be accepted. You want boys to like you, all these things. Unfortunately, those win conditions are temporary. First of all, likability, you can't control if someone likes you, and that is outwardly focusing you to be dependent on someone else's opinion of you. Mm-hmm. And then attractiveness is a very short window of our lives, hopefully, and especially in this society where it's like a window of 20 to 22. You know, it's a very... narrow thing, and then you're investing a lot of your emotional well-being into something that's dependent on other people and will go away. And I think that's really short changes all of us. So my win conditions growing up were being smart and achieving things, and that's just the way I grew up. And especially the kind of conformity and those conditions, I think, lead girls to abandon things that might have a long-term benefit for them, mm-hmm. or they might just enjoy. Mm-hmm. Like, I can't tell you how many people are like, even today, like, you write about gaming, you know, are you really, did you write, you know, I even write about the guild, like a guy was like, did you really write this by yourself? And I'm like, yeah, I mean, but it's reality, and it's not, and it's very subtle, and even, I don't think that they mean anything by it, you know, I think it's just a subtle bias that we grow up with, that this person is, looks like this and they should behave like this. This person is this race and that's the way I think about them instantly. This is this person of this sex, that's what they should be. And we have these, especially media reinforces all those.
Yeah.
But we're trapped by those things because we will subtly change our lives to conform to other people's expectations of us based on our appearance. And that's why I love the internet, because we escape that a little bit. I wrote The Guild because 6 people, different ages, different backgrounds, different races, different sexes, all were friends together because they loved something together. And that's what geekdom does for us. If I meet somebody who loves Fallout, I want to talk about Fallout. I don't care where they're from, what they look like. We have something in common together that brings us together as humans. And the more we can do that in this world, I think we're better off because we see each other more versus like see the expectation. That's another quote.
Oh. This is going to be in the radio, so somebody write it down.
Radioquote.com.
It's interesting, you know, when you talk about the small window that you have as a woman to be considered to live up to those expectations.
Yep.
My own unsolicited advice for young girls. When I was 20 years old, I read a book written for women to read the day they turned 50. It was called I Could Do Anything I Wanted If I Only Knew What It Was. And the book's like, do not read this book unless you're 50 because you won't get it. But like when you hit 50, the world stops seeing you as a woman.
Yeah.
And you're sort of aged out of beautiful and being sexy and interesting to people in that way. And it's like, yay, now you get to live your life for you because you no longer have to live up to those expectations. I read that when I was like 20 years old.
Wow.
And I was like, I'm a 50-year-old lady now. And that's how I live my life. And
yeah.
So.
Well, it's a freedom of other people's expectation. Yeah. I think women, you know, we like to be likable, so we want to fit in. And I, you know, I have a lot of people who have opinions about me that are not accurate in my eyes, and I can't chase them down. I can just stand up and say, no, I'm not, and I'm not going away. Mm-hmm. So that's all I can do. And that's when somebody comes up to me, like a little girl came up to me at VidCon and was like, hey, I'm in my class, and people tell me girls don't game. What do I do? Mm-hmm. And I told her, you just have to be brave. You have to stand up and say, well, you're not correct because I do this. And for more people who do that, they can open doors for people who are younger than her mm-hmm. so that maybe people will be educated that cliche or that thing you're putting on her, that is not accurate. And so let's just play together.
Yeah. Awesome. I love it. That's good. Well, so we have time for more questions. I assume nobody's yanking us off the stage yet. Here's a very practical one. Who would you like to play in the Marvel Cinematic Universe? Do you have any thoughts there?
Squirrel Girl. Yeah. Right? I have the worst overbite known to man, and I can't fix it unless I crack my jaw and move it forward and am in traction for 8 months. So I'm like, it's perfect casting. Typecast me, please. I have buck teeth. and commanding squirrels.
Yes.
Super, that's super powerful.
Here's something we've all wondered about from Chris, who will recognize their question in a moment. Is Nathan Fillion really that handsome?
Wow. Thanks, Nathan.
Chris, right? All right.
Chris. yes, Nathan Fillion is that handsome, is that nice, and he gives some of the best hugs in the business.
Aww.
What? He smells like sunshine. That's it. I'm not kidding. It's an in-joke.
All right. Amber has, I think, a really interesting question. I don't know. Does Amber want to weave? There's Amber. I have a rare medical condition that has forced me to give up much of what I love. What advice would you give to stay optimistic?
That's sad. I'm sorry, Amber. But I would say that there's so much to love, and the fact that some doors close means that you're able to see other doors open. And there's so many joyous things in this world, and you now have the opportunity, you get to discover what else you are that you might never even have discovered had this thing not happened to you. So I would just be really proactive in searching. Your job is to find that thing. You're on a quest. And out on that quest and try so many different things. And you're going to find that thing that really brings you joy again. And you're going to be so grateful for the opportunity for that. So I'm excited for you.
Aw, that's good. So you obviously give great advice because there are a lot of questions about advice. There are a lot of questions in here about panic attacks, actually.
I got this covered.
Yeah.
I'm so good at panic attacks.
What have you done that's been most successful for you? What advice do you give? There are literally like five questions.
Really? About panic attacks? Who has panic attacks in the audience? Yeah, panic attacks. I really didn't know I had panic attacks. I did know that when I would go to audition for things, I would have an out-of-body experience where I didn't have control over my body. Hmm. I literally did not have the facility to say no or stop. And I would go 1,000 miles per hour in the audition and just be on autopilot, literally watching myself from afar. And then I would go out, and then an hour later, it would crush my soul, because I would come back into my body and realize I did not do what I wanted to do there. I was not in control of myself. So, and you know, I do have a lot of, you know, I still have panic attacks. They're very hard to deal with. But the great thing is that I've educated myself. And I think that's the first step, is to know yourself. Like, treat yourself like a science experiment almost, and be like, oh, so I had a panic attack. These are the symptoms under which, these are the pressures, these are the triggers, these are what happens to my body. So I started to be aware, so that when I was in a panic attack, I would see myself having the panic attack and be able to get into my body faster. And every single time I repeated that acknowledgement and, oh, I'm having a panic attack, this is happening, pulling myself back into my body, it got easier over time. And I think that's the knowledge. You need to, in order to master yourself, you have to know yourself better. And so I would treat yourself like a research project and just really figure out what are those triggers and protect yourself. Like, I would say no for actually the year that I wrote the book, I said no to anything that stressed me out in the slightest. Hmm. So I was able to get to a point where I felt safe, that I was protecting myself, because in my mind, that person having a panic attack is a 5-year-old version of me. And instead of being angry at myself, I would look at myself and I would hug myself as a little 5-year-old, because I was scared. And it wasn't something to be mad at. It was something I couldn't control. And I think doing those things slowly but surely, training myself, especially with the awareness, really helped. So hopefully that helps somebody, because it helped me immensely.
That's fantastic. Thank you. This is sweet. I don't know who wrote this. Maybe they want to wave. Felicia, I love your voice.
I like you.
Will you be doing any more singing? Have you ever thought about doing a Broadway show? Also, you are more lovely in person than I could imagine.
Oh my gosh. Who said
I really
this?
Like you?
Yeah, who's that? That was like a like something slipped somebody in a classroom that I'd never been to. So, yes, I love. I actually hate singing, but I used to hate singing. So that is something I also have panic attacks about, and I still do. I can't say that in acting, even talking, and I seem really confident and together. If I were to audition in front of you, I would be a nightmare inside. Mm. And if I were to sing in front of you, I would be dying inside. Oh. I would really be having a panic attack in a very real way. And it's getting better, but it's certainly not there. That's just something that I might just carry through my life. But I think it was early on, I was thrust in the position to singing or acting in front of people, and I wasn't prepared, and I didn't feel like I was prepared. And I think when you have a traumatic situation like that, where you feel like you're not protected, I think that's where those things start. So slowly but surely, it's getting better. And I do love singing, and a lot of the singing I do is in videos where I can just record it and be happy with it and then go away. So I'd love to do more singing and performing. That's kind of hopefully the next year of my life, is getting back to that creativity and doing, you know, kind of the projects that I write, as well as just acting in other people's things. And if music comes along, it would be awesome. Broadway, I don't know, because I'd have to move away and I have a company, and they're just like, you need to do this company thing. So, and I love my company, so I wouldn't want to leave it for so long. Maybe in Los Angeles doing a beauty. That would be cool. Don't put it on my list. I'm so busy.
I mean, I'm sure you get asked this question everywhere, so let's just ask it again. Speaking of singing, have you heard anything about a Dr. Horrible sing-along blog part?
Well, it's obviously a good idea.
Yeah, come on, just announce it right now. Let's make
a
public announcement.
Somebody will. For like a couple years after Dr. Horrible, whenever I'd be like, you know, I would love the opportunity, of course, if they did something, but I think they're kind of busy, but they're thinking about it. Felicia Day announces, you know, I'm like, what are you doing? I did not announce anything. That project was such a formative, I mean, I think it's, that project is so much more important than I think right now is giving it. I think in retrospect, Dr. Horrible will be a huge turning point where Hollywood kind of was like, to the internet. Because Joss and Jed and Marissa and Zach got together and made something that was TV quality in their backyards, kind of, and self-funded it, and didn't wait for someone to give them permission to say something. And I think that really had a ripple effect, especially in creators in Hollywood, to the point where now we're seeing kind of an influx of legitimate Hollywood productions done for the web. Mm-hmm. And I think it's just gonna get bigger and bigger and bigger because the web now is our cable box. Like, I don't know, that whole set thing, the cable box set thing, we're not gonna have that in 5 to 10 years, or it'll be a different version of it. So I think it's really interesting, and I think that project not only created a family that I feel like I'll always belong to, but it really affected a lot of people in a lot of ways. So I hope they do something, and if they don't, it will always be one of the most precious memories that I have as an actor. So, is that good?
That's good.
No announcement.
That's good.
Not an announcement.
A very important question. By the way, you have to take these home because there's some really sweet notes. Everybody's written very nice things.
Okay.
Something we all wonder about, how does it feel to be so awesome?
I don't know.
Okay.
I like you too.
All right, so... What is your favorite book that you've read recently? Get us all reading something after we finish this amazing memoir.
Oh, gosh. Well, I read your book.
Oh,
Super
I didn't ask this question. This is not my handwriting.
No, it's not.
I'm no Nathan, you know, writing, you know.
I really did love your book. I actually am a self-help book aficionado, and yours was awesome because it combined gaming with self-help. So very, very highly recommended. I read Jenny Lawson's new book, which she's the bloggess. Yes. And if you read, she writes about anxiety and depression in an amazing way, and it's so funny, and there's so much taxidermy in there that it creeps me out. I read a book called Ink and Bone by my friend Rachel Kane, who it's kind of like Harry Potter for libraries, which is weird, but it's a really good book. I read the Neal Stephenson, Seven E's, come on, it's a weird word. Seven E's. Oh, that's it. It's two words? No wonder I can't pronounce that. Anyway, that's an amazing book because on page one, the moon blows up and then everything after that is like... It's the first sentence.
So can I ask you a saucy question, yes or no?
What does saucy mean?
Sort of vaginal fantasy question.
All right.
You can always say pass.
What is going on here?
But they wrote a bribe to get you to answer it. You're the best, happy face.
Okay.
Shag, marry, kill. Neil Patrick Harris. Nathan Fillion, and Will Wheaton. Who wrote that question? Who gets credit for that right there?
Nope. Nope. Nope.
Okay.
Nope. Mary and marry them all, because that sounds fancy.
That sounds fancy.
That sounds safe.
Will we ever get a Where Are They Now Guild season?
Where Are They Now? Do you mean like a fast forward?
Yeah, like we'll catch up with their
You home. Know, the cool thing is I still own the show, and I talk about the end of it, which was not, you know, I was burned out. I had a burnout, which is, if you look at burnout, it's like, that's me. That's Felicia Day. So I'm just getting to the point where I really love, I think really fondly about the characters, and I wait for the day where I get a really good idea to do something with them. I don't know if we do like live action, because I don't know, that seems, unless we do like Golden Guild, that seems...
Yes.
You know, I could see something, I could definitely see something happening maybe in comics or animation or something like that. Like, I love the characters so much. So I wouldn't rule it out, and no one could tell me no, which is kind of nice. So, you know, I would play with the idea. If something really came to light, the reason why I ended it, because I wrote it for 6.5 years by myself, is because I didn't know that I had the best story to tell. And I would never, I always feel sad for, you know, when people tell people, you know, obviously creators do the show past the time it was done. And so, you know, if I were to get that creative spark again, now that I have a free moment after this book is over, that would be cool. But I do have a couple of other projects that I love dearly that I'm trying to get made. So,
are you gonna spill any, like, use cryptic words that when it happens, we'll know that we heard about it? You know what I'm saying. Give us like a clue that, like, when it happens 3 years from now.
Oh my gosh.
We'll be like, gee, that's what she was telling us about.
Wow, I just love San Francisco. I don't know. I'm not gonna tell you anything because it's not made yet.
Wait, was that a cryptic clue though?
You don't know.
All right, well played, well played. I like it. Well, maybe this will be another cryptic clue. Who do you really want to work with that you haven't worked with yet?
I want to be in something with Simon Pegg, even if I'm a creepy extra in the background. I'll pretend to pour water behind him. I'll go like... He's amazing. And Edgar Wright, I mean, that whole group is like unbelievably talented and totally... sensibility I would love to be. I always look like, why can't I be their friend? You know, I mean, we have those groups like Judd Apatow. I don't smoke pot, so I don't can't be the friends with them, can I? Maybe, yeah. I'd like to. I mean, not this hot part, but I'll just be friends. It's fine, I'm not judging anybody. Do what you need to do, honestly.
Okay.
I'm gonna have a panic attack about that trying to sleep tonight. I'll write you all an email.
I love it. Okay, so you're such an inspiration to so many people.
Yeah.
Who is
Yep.
Who are some people who are inspiring you lately?
Oh, wow, that's a good question. I mean, I'm really inspired by the fans that we have, like our community, because every day, like the things that they do to enable each other, really it makes me know that the internet is the awesome place it is. Like the internet can have some dark things and depressing things and things that give it a bad rep, but to me, the beauty of the internet is that we're connecting with each other and allowing ourselves to be ourselves, and I think that's really key. So I guess that's one thing that inspires me. I'm also inspired by when I meet younger fans, actually, I'm really inspired to go out and set a good example, like to be the person that they might be interested in. I'm also inspired by you know, politics. I mean, I can't really tweet about politics because I can't deal with the hatred that comes back. I mean, it's just people get really, and I get it. There's a lot of things that are sort of trigger things that we could supersede those beliefs. We can disagree in areas but agree about other ones. And I always want to make people feel included. But you know, I think it's really interesting what's happening, and people being activists really interests me because I actually have a picture in my book where my mom. She volunteered for the Perot campaign, Ross Perot. He was an independent candidate in like 94 or whatever. And we would go on the road. We would just go in Kentucky and Louisville and go to rallies. And he was kind of a kooky dude, but he was a self-funded millionaire. And he was like, I'm going to be president. And he had all these out-of-the-box ideas. And he got like, he would have won. He could have won. He got like 20-30% of the vote, and then he dropped out at the last minute. But it was kind of this weird zeitgeist where we're all outsiders punching the inside people. And I guess that's why I am who I am, because I'm always like trying to come from the outside and tell people, hey, those rules you have don't have to be rules. And maybe it's spiteful. I don't know. Maybe I'm just a person who likes breaking things. But there is that But there is that impulse in me. So when I see like activists in all areas of race, religion, sex, like I really appreciate that. And I think that people should be enabled in polite ways, you know, ways that are respectful to each other, even if you don't agree with each other, to change people's minds. Yep. And I think that's inspiring.
Very cool. Well, I can't let you go without asking you about Supernatural, because there are a lot of Supernatural fans here. They want to know about it. They want to know what your favorite part of that experience has been. Tell us a little bit of an inside fun time.
Well, Supernatural is amazing, and I was supposed to only... What was that? Oh, I hit my mic. I was like, was that a gong?
Are we...
yeah, I like to flip it. Supernatural is amazing. I was only supposed to do one episode, wow, which was great, and it was right the month Geek & Sundry was launching, so I was like, I should not do this. I'm going to do this. Because the part was amazing, and it was a show I wanted to be on for years, and it was season 7, and I'm like, this show's about to be canceled. I was convinced that if I didn't get in now, I wouldn't get on. So I did the one episode, and it went so amazingly. And they kept asking me back. And that was 4 seasons. And I was blessed with every single script, because not only is Charlie a smart girl, and she happens to like geeky things, and she happens to be a lesbian, but she's not those things. She's not that one thing that you see on TV, like, oh, that's the geek girl. No, Charlie was a real character. And the way that her backstory was explored by that writer, Robbie Thompson. He wrote every single episode except for my last episode. And his voice is so strong and amazing and celebrated geek things in a way that didn't make them a cliche. And I appreciate that, because there are a lot of parts I get offered and it's like, no, I'm not. I'm not going to wear that t-shirt and those glasses and just be derpy. You know, I'm just not doing it. So it was an amazing journey, and the guys, Jared and Jensen, are hilarious. And my favorite story I like to tell is, did anybody see the episode where I played Dark and Light Charlie? So that was a really challenging situation. I was like, this is going to be hard. And I worked really, really hard, but I worked a lot with Jensen, who Dark Charlie, the evil Charlie, was kind of a sassy B2. So... She did something really obnoxious, and she confronted him at a bar, mm-hmm, and we're at a bar together, and she's like, in the script, it says Dark Charlie leans over, takes Dean's shot, and throws it back. Well, true story, until that point, I had never thrown a shot back. I don't know how to swim, I don't like putting my face underwater, and those things plus a small cup equal danger. To me. So I was like, no, I don't think so. So, but I had to do it. So, you know, we get to the scene, and it's on Jensen's coverage, and I go, and I take the shot, and I'm looking, and I'm really sassy, like. I throw it back, and I slam it, and then water goes. just pouring down my face. And rather than be like, oh, sorry, let's reset, I just kept going. Wiped my face off, and I kept going. We got through the scene, and Jensen is one of the most professional actors you ever meet. He, like, nails every scene he's ever in. He's, like, one-take master. And the closest I ever saw him to breaking was, like, when I threw the water on myself, it was like... just a little twitch in the mouth, just on the side there, and it was like cut. He was like, what the hell was that? I mean, those guys are some of the most authentic, lovely people I've ever met, and I am privileged to be on that set with them. So yeah, it was a great experience. Supernatural
is
awesome.
That is a super hilarious story, and this book is full of stories as super hilarious as that.
I don't name drop my famous friends that much because I thought that was tacky, but there are some good stories.
There are some hilarious stories. And you guys are all going to get it and read it and love it, and you're going to sign some copies.
I will sign, guys. If you haven't gotten a signed copy, I will be signing and like taking quick pictures. It will go quickly. But because people want to go to sleep at a certain point. But I look forward to meeting all of you, and I really hope you enjoy the book. I really put my heart and soul into it. So your being here tonight is a huge celebration.
Oh,
for me.
Let's hear it for Felicia. Thank you.
lovely. There you go.